toward heaven, and it became a boil breaking forth with blains upon man and upon beast. And the magicians could not stand before Moses because of the boils. And the boil was upon the magicians and upon all the Egyptians.
Amen.
Not half of them, all.
Amen.
So we read here that God said, take ashes out of the furnace and throw it up toward heaven, and it will become boils on all the Egyptians.
Amen.
Now we read here in this passage of scripture that the magicians couldn't stand it.
Amen.
10:4-6. Else if thou refuse to let my people go, behold, tomorrow will I bring the locusts into thy coast, and they shall cover the face of the earth, and that one cannot be able to see the earth, and they shall eat the residue of that which is escaped, which remaineth unto you from the hail, and shall eat every tree which groweth for you out of the field. And they shall fill thy houses, and the houses of all thy servants, and the houses of all the Egyptians, which neither thy fathers nor thy fathers' fathers have seen, since the day that they were upon the earth unto this day. And he turned himself and went out from Pharaoh. Now, locusts are a swarming phase of grasshoppers.
Amen.
That's their description. So, and they came to the Egyptians' crops. Now, I'm not sure if back then the crops were important, but I think they were important.
Amen.
And the locusts ate what was left from what the hail had destroyed.
Amen.
Oh, I skipped hail.
Praise the Lord.
9:18-26. Behold, tomorrow about this time, I will cause it to rain a very grievous hail, such as hath not been in Egypt since the foundation thereof, even until now. Send therefore now, and gather thy cattle, and all that thou hast in the field, for upon every man and beast which shall be found in the field, and shall not be brought home, the hail shall come down upon them, and they shall die. He that feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his cattle flee into the houses. And he that regarded not the word of the Lord left his servants and his cattle in the field. And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch forth thine hand toward heaven, that there may be hail in all the land of Egypt, upon man and upon beast, and on every herb of the field throughout the land of Egypt. And Moses stretched forth his rod toward heaven, and the Lord sent thunder and hail, and the fire ran along upon the ground. And the Lord rained hail upon the land of Egypt. So there was hail, and fire mingled with the hail, very grievous, heavy. Such as there was none like it in all the land of Egypt since it became a nation. And the hail smote throughout all the land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast. And the hail smote every herb of the field, and brake every tree of the field. Only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, was there no hail. So we read that God sends hail to Egypt and not Israel.
Amen.
He kept his people Actually, this whole time he kept his people safe.
Amen.
Everything hit Egypt.
Yeah.
Here. Now, hail can be about 5.9 inches big. Is that big or?
Pretty big.
I think so.
Almost 6 inches.
Now, and the Egyptians had to go through all of it, and it says that it was horrible, and fire came along with it.
Amen.
Exodus 10:22-23. And Moses stretched forth his hand toward heaven, and there was a thick darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. They saw not one another, neither rose any from his place for 3 days. But all the children of Israel had light in their dwellings.
Amen.
Now, in Egypt there was darkness, in Israel there was light.
Amen. So,
and everybody was probably running into each other since it was so dark.
Amen.
Exodus 11:4-5. And Moses said, Thus saith the Lord, about midnight will I go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sitteth upon his throne, even unto the firstborn of the maidservant that is behind the mill, and all the firstborn of beasts. Now, this was a very devastating plague on Egypt.
Amen.
Now, Egypt's children, they were all gonna die that night. But Israel's, they were kept safe.
Amen.
Now, tonight it's the same thing because Israel had to put blood on their doorposts and...
Come on.
And tonight it's the same thing.
Amen.
As long as we're washed in the blood, we ain't gonna go into the pits of hell.
Amen. Amen.
Now, how did all this happen? It was because Pharaoh wouldn't let the people go.
Yeah. Amen.
Now, this makes at least me think that he cared more about his kingdom than his son. If he knew what was going to happen to his son that night,
yeah,
he probably would have let him go.
Yeah.
All right, 13, 17, and 14, and 29, but we ain't going to read that. It's a pretty long passage. It's pretty long. And this is the parting of the Red Sea.
Yeah.
This is probably the most powerful miracle of all. It's the most, how do you say it? I can't find a word to say it. The greatest miracle in the book of Exodus.
Yeah.
The sea was in front of the Israelites and Pharaoh was behind them.
Yeah.
God told Moses to stretch out his staff around, was it above the Red Sea? Over the Red Sea, and it parted.
Yeah.
And they all crossed. Now, there is something that is pretty hard to understand. Some people think that it opened up right away, and some people have it where they got to the end, it finished opening up. In the Ten Commandments movie, we have the sea opening all at once. And in a movie called The Prince of Egypt, at the end, when they got to the end of the Red Sea, it finished opening up. So there's two different ways. It's the same way with David and Goliath, with any David and Goliath movie. Some people have it to where David misses four times, and the last stone hits him. Some people has it that the stone kills him. Now, what I think is that the stone knocked him out, and when David cut his head off, he had died and went down into hell.
Amen.
All right, now you have all 12 miracles of the Exodus.
Amen.